We're going to reconvene the Richland 2 board meeting for the Richland 2 Board of Trustees, where we're coming back from executive session, where we discuss the items that were mentioned in the motion to go into executive session. At this time, we will have the inspirational moment, Dr. Elkins Johnson.
Yes. Good evening, everyone. It's so nice to see everyone here. We will have our inspirational moment by Dr. Nancy Gregory. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening.
When Dr. Hamm and Dr. Davis recently shared an overview of Richland 2 with our advanced ed visitors, the audience as well as the visitors were brought to tears by the emotional and heartwarming video stories they shared about our students and staff members. Several of these stories focused on service projects. In one video, a story was shared about how Blythewood High School students gave a local family a fresh start after their home was destroyed by the thousand-year flood. In another video, the story of how Westwood High students adopted every member of a nursing home in the community during the holidays was shared. I felt such pride for our students and staff members as I watched the story Dr. Hamm and Dr. Davis shared unfold about how something special happens in Richland 2 every day. The level of community service and service learning that occurs in our district on an ongoing basis is incredible. I thought about a story that Franklin Covey uses in his well-known Seven Habits series. Covey shares that there are two seas that are made by the River Jordan. One sea is fresh and fish live in it. Splashes of green adorn its banks. Trees spread their branches over it and stretch out over the thirsty roots to sip its waters. The River Jordan makes this sea with sparkling water from the hills. Men build their houses near it and birds build their nest. And every kind of life is happier because it is there. The River Jordan flows south into another sea. Here there is no splash of fish, no song of birds, no children's laughter. Travelers choose another route, unless on urgent business. The air hangs heavy above the water, and neither man nor beast will drink that water. What makes the difference in these two neighboring seas? It's not the River Jordan. It empties the same good water into both. It's not the soil on which they lie. This is the difference. The first sea receives, but it doesn't keep the Jordan. For every drop that flows into it, another drop flows out. The giving and receiving go on in equal measure. The other sea is shrewder, hoarding its income. Every drop it gets, it keeps. The first sea gives and lives. The other sea gives nothing. You may have heard of that second sea. It's appropriately called the Dead Sea. Covey's story makes you think about the power of giving and sharing one's gifts. So tonight's inspirational moment is focused around serving others. I hope that our students and staff will continue to give back to our community just as the first sea does, as they have so generously done. That's where true joy can be found. I'm going to end with a quote from Albert Pike. What we have done for ourselves alone dies with us, but what we have done for others and the world remains and is immortal. Thank you to our great students and staff who truly make something special happen in Richland 2 every day. And let's never take for granted all the great things that happen in our district. If you'll now join me for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much for that truly inspirational comment. I will definitely think of that in the Dead Sea going forward. Approval of the agenda, if I can have a motion, please.
So moved.
So moved by Ms. Agostini. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Ms. Mackey. Is there any discussion? With no discussion, we'll have the vote at this time. And the motion passes 7-0. Next on our agenda is our faculty focus, Dr. Hamm.
We'll bring Nancy Gregory up again to introduce the faculty focus.
Good evening again, Chairman Manning, school board members, and Dr. Hamm. Dr. Teresa Riley Stevens from the Communications Department is moving to the podium. She will share an overview of the district's annual QuizWiz competition. Dr. Stevens has directed this wonderful opportunity for middle schoolers since 2011. For tonight's faculty focus, middle school teachers Ms. Maria Carter from E.L. Wright and Dr. Allison Benoit from Summit Parkway Middle School will share their experiences with QuizWiz.
It's all very simple. Come up with an idea, surround yourself with the right people to make it happen, and that sums up the creation of QuizWiz. Good evening, everyone. As the Richland 2 television team and I explored programming possibilities way back when, we thought about fun ways that we could get students involved, give them a platform to showcase their knowledge. We wanted to create experiences where they would be able to collaborate as teams and where they would be able to independently answer questions. QuizWiz is similar to the National Academic Quiz Tournament. It's not a game of trivia. It has rigorous pyramid-style questions that are supposed to get easier as the moderator reads, but that's not always the case. Kelly Mill was the first school to win the tournament, and Dent the most recent. Maria Zambrana Carter is the first coach to win, who is still in the district and still in the game. She will share her team's experiences.
Good evening. Thank you for allowing us to share a little bit about the QuizWiz Academic Tournament. This was a venture that started several years ago and has become an event that many students look forward to at the middle school level. I've been the QuizWiz coach for the last 7 years at E.L. Wright Middle School and can say that all of my team members have enjoyed having an opportunity to showcase their knowledge. The QuizWiz tournament provides students who are gifted academically a chance to shine on stage as their athletic peers do on the fields and the courts. Over the years, I've had students who were quiet but confident in the classroom join the team and come alive. QuizWiz provided them an outlet to grow out of their shell. These students have had an immense amount of pride being on a team, and as their coach, I have enjoyed seeing many of them grow as they've joined the team in sixth grade and eventually become a team captain by their eighth grade year. I would now like to turn the presentation over to Dr. Benoit from Summit Parkway Middle School to share a little more about her experience.
Thank you. I've worked for several years now helping to coach our team from Summit Parkway with Mrs. Robinson, who is also on the faculty at Summit Parkway. And we've had the great privilege of coming in first place. We've also finished in the middle of the pack, and we've also finished in last place. And I can say with absolute honesty that I was as proud of our team this year when we finished in last place as I was the year that we finished in first place. This year, I was particularly proud of our students after the first day of competition because it was very clear at that point that their dreams of what they thought was going to happen during the competition was not going to happen, and they acknowledged that, and they were a little bit down in the mouth, as you might expect. But we came back to our room and got together, and I just very simply asked them, okay, what are your thoughts? What are you thinking? Have you learned anything today that you can share? And they very quickly came up with some amazing self-assessments and thoughts about what they had done well, what they might do differently if they could do it again. So it was truly without prompting from myself or Mrs. Robinson that they were able to do that, which I think is just a really remarkable thing for sixth, seventh, and eighth graders to be able to do. I think the QuizWiz provides opportunities for a lot of lifelong skills for these children. I think it encourages them and helps them build a lifelong attitude of curiosity and a thirst for knowledge that will serve them well. It helps them learn to work together as a team and to celebrate each other's successes. It helps them to develop an ethic of persistence when challenged with what is difficult. It helps to build confidence in themselves and their abilities. And I think it's very important that it recognizes academic achievement in a world where often we are attuned to recognizing athletic achievement. I asked some of the students who'd been on our previous teams to answer a couple questions for me about what they felt about their experiences, and I wanted to share those with you. The first couple of students actually came from this year's team, which, as I said, we finished last. Robert said, I gained a lot more confidence from this experience and learned to speak out more. I would recommend that other students try to participate in QuizWiz because it really teaches you things and lets you do things you would never have thought to do. For example, I answered several questions in a row and found myself practicing at home by looking in my notebook and searching random facts constantly. And he did truly show tremendous growth and confidence throughout our year. Emmanuel said that I learned that teamwork is very crucial when doing QuizWiz. Always be prepared and don't be afraid to answer because anything could happen. Atifa and Clary, I've kind of combined their responses. Every student can get, and these were on previous, students were on a previous team. Every student can get the opportunity to answer questions in a category that they are good at. For example, if someone isn't good at math, they may get the sports questions. Answering the questions can increase students' self-confidence and make them more enthusiastic about learning. It encourages students to learn for the purpose of learning instead of just for school. And then this last one is from, Isak Jatoy, who was on the team the year that we won and has just recently been recognized as part of the Spring Valley team that was recently named National Academic Quiz Tournament's High School Team of the Week for the week of March 18th this year. And Isak was instrumental in founding that QuizWiz team. He said, I have learned countless random facts from studying for QuizWiz, and I have also learned about working under pressure from the competitions. Additionally, during high school QuizWiz, I have learned organizational skills as I organize meetings and competitions for the team to go to. I would recommend that other students join QuizWiz because I have thoroughly enjoyed it. It has helped me in my classes by improving my study skills, and it has helped me in test taking by making me comfortable when working under pressure. The district should continue to have a yearly QuizWiz tournament because it can provide many fun opportunities for students and can help encourage better academic and social skills. And now we have a short video that shows some of this year's competitions.
The Hubble Tuning Fork classifies these objects based on their structure. Lenticular ones with central bulges appear at the center of the fork. Arms extend from the spiral type of these collections.
Galaxy?
That's correct. This operation on two sets gives the set of all elements that are in either or both of the original sets.
Union?
This is the name for the set with no elements. It is often denoted by a circle with a slash through it.
Empty set?
That's correct. A former religious leader in this country, Fethullah Gulen, lives in self-imposed exile in Pennsylvania. Gulen has been accused of orchestrating a failed 2016 coup in this country that tried to overthrow President Recep Tayyip Erdogan. For 10 points, name this nation governed from Ankara.
Turkey.
Turkey's correct. Voltaire called this person the Star of the North and maintained a correspondence with this ruler. This ruler's lovers included the general Grigory Potemkin and Stanislaw Poniatowski, the latter of whom was placed on the throne of Poland. For 10 points, name this Russian empress.
Catherine.
Need more information.
Catherine the Great.
That's correct. This man resigned as First Lord of the Admiralty after the failure of the Gallipoli campaign. He warned of an iron curtain descending across Europe and attended the Yalta Conference with Stalin and Roosevelt. For 10 points, who was the British Prime Minister during most of World War II?
Winston Churchill.
That's correct.
Thank you.
right. Do you have any questions for our team?
Board members, questions, comments? Ms. Mackey.
Just a comment. I appreciate your presentation, and I've enjoyed seeing snippets of the Quiz Whiz on R2 TV for over the years, and I appreciate it, especially the comment about celebrating academic successes as well as sports successes. So I appreciate that. Well done. Keep up the great work.
We appreciate Dr. Stevens and this endeavor.
Yes,
and
yes.
Tonight we have the coaches from the middle schools, and we're just going to ask them to stand. And also Michelle Wyatt, who is our facilitator. So if the middle school coaches that are here, if you'll please stand so that you can be recognized.
All right.
And Dr. Michelle Wyatt, our wonderful facilitator.
Do we have students here tonight from the Quiz Whiz?
We don't have the students here tonight, just the teachers, the coaches were here tonight.
Yeah, well, they...
Or do we?
Oh, okay, yeah.
Because we have some coaches over here. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't...
Yeah, can we have the students stand up?
Would you stand to be recognized, too?
Thank you. I got to tell you, if y'all came in last, you just picked the wrong people to go against. Because if you put us up there, you would have won first. All day, every day with your hands tied behind your backs after those questions and answers. So thank you very much for what you do and for the hard work that you put into that. We're proud of you. Thank you.
Right. Thank you.
Great job. All right. Next on our agenda, we have special recognitions. Dr. Hamm.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, we're very fortunate that month after month we have special recognitions and teachers as well as students that we can recognize. But this time of year, we really have an abundance of those, and it's our good fortune to be able to introduce them tonight, and Libby Roof will be doing that.
It's the greatest time of year.
Yeah.
These people are here.
Yep.
Dr. Hamm, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, staff, most importantly, our community members, teachers, students who are here to be recognized. For the next several board meetings, it's going to look like this.
Yeah.
Because just like there's the award season for the movies, you know, you have the Oscars, the Golden Globes. Well, this is awards time for the schools. As you get near the end of the schools, they start racking up in Richland, too. They really do. So we have a lot of people to recognize, and we're going to get to it. Since we just left off with Quiz Whiz, we're going to recognize our Quiz Whiz champions for 2007, and they are from Dent Middle School. And the team members' names are up here, and I will call the ones that I believe are with us tonight, and I'm going to do my very best with the pronunciation of the names. Sparsho D. Zachary, come on forward. Zachary Wong. Shirak Garish. And Parth Patel. Did I get all our students? And our coaches are Mark Turner and Kathy Stinson. You want to come forward and... And if Principal Tamala Ashford is here, if she'll come up and join her students. And y'all stay up front because you got to get a photograph. And let me tell them a little bit. As you heard, this is a 2 days of intense competition. And they beat out teams from 6 other middle schools. Dent has won 3 times. They won the tournament this year in 2014 and 2015. And it is not a game of trivia pursuit. The questions are tough. It's a rigorous pyramid-style question focused on academics and subjects including history, literature, science, fine arts, current events, and sports. And you can watch it on R2 TV right now. Congratulations. We now have 2 talented artists we're going to bring forward. Abigail Lanier of Lake Carolina Elementary Upper and Aubriana McClurklin of Catawba Trail Elementary. And we have, I believe their principals are with them, Mr. Jeff Williams and Denise Barth. Abigail's right there, all right. Abigail and Aubriana have been named state winners in the 2016 Conservation Poster Contest, sponsored by the South Carolina Association of Conservation Districts. Abigail won in the second and third grade division, and Aubriana in the fourth and sixth grade category. That's not Mr. Williams, but yeah. Yes. Ms. Cray is standing in for him today. Each student created a poster illustrating the theme, "We All Need Trees." The theme was selected to raise awareness about the importance of trees to people, wildlife, the environment, and the economy. We have their posters up on the screen. Abigail's is first. One side of the tree depicts trees meeting nature's need, and the other side illustrates how trees meet people's needs. Aubriana's poster, next, shows a cross-section of a tree trunk nestled in a bed of autumn leaves with spiraled lists of the more than 100 goods and services. Is that inside the tree?
Yeah.
Oh, very cool.
That's really cool, yeah.
Provided by the trees. Congratulations, Abigail and Aubriana.
Very nice.
Now we turn to student achievements in athletics. Will Armani Grice from Ridgeview High School please come forward, along with your principal, Dr. Brenda Mack-Foxworth, athletic director Brian Rosefeld, and basketball coach Terrence Gibson. Carolina All-Stars Basketball Classic is the premier high school senior basketball tournament for North Carolina and South Carolina. 40 of the top North and South Carolina high school seniors, including our own Armani player, were invited to be part of the 20th annual event. Players have the honor of representing their school and their state in this competition between North Carolina and South Carolina. The game was held last month in Myrtle Beach. Now, South Carolina didn't win. Armani tried to pull the team through. She did everything she could. You know, she's going to not blame her, but we know it was not because of her. But she does end her stellar high school career on top, and she has future plans to attend and play at UNC Asheville, and we wish her all the best, and thank you for giving your years here at Richland, too. If the Ridgeview administrators, coaches want to stay, we got North-South basketball players. Y'all can just come on back up here. And we will ask your players, Najarji Bejir. Did I get close to it? No? Najar? Najir. Shelly told me, and I didn't make my notes. Najir Bejir. Barger. I really...
Wow.
Narjir Barge. Is that better? Okay. We know this beautiful lady right here.
Yeah.
Caden Rice from Ridgeview, along with Keith Matthews from Blythewood, and we'll have Dr. Brenda Hafner and is Gary Barry Mizell here, and our coach. Yes, and then we have Cameron Warmack from Westwood. And Dr. Cheryl Guy, Jason Powell, Jeffrey DePista. Got all our players, coaches, athletic directors, principals, everybody. We can play basketball. Do we have enough?
Yeah.
Y'all want to go ahead? There we go.
All right, guys, y'all can slide in together for me, please.
Now, the athletes up here, our players, the boys and girls, they played on the North-South game at Lexington High School. They represented Richland 2 in the girls or the boys competition, and they did a great job. Narjay wraps up a great high school career, ranked third in the state, and helping Ridgeview girls win the Region 3-4-A championship. And she scored 4 points on the North team. Again, her team didn't win. She tried to pull them through, but it was up to people. For the boys, 11 was the magic number for the three players to invite us to play in the North-South game. Keith Matthews, Cam Warmack, and Caden Rice each scored 11 points. It's pretty cool. Keith played on the South team and was named the MVP for the tournament. Keith, right here. Tight game. The South beat the North 106-102. But what's most important, we had a great representation of Richland 2 on both those teams. We're so proud of you, and thank you again for your years in Richland 2, and best of luck as you go on to your next level. Congratulations. Our next recognition is Spring Valley teacher Tammy Vaught. Tammy, if you'll come forward with your principal, Jeff Timoney. Ms. Vaught has won a top award in technology from the National Center for Women in Information Technology and ITology. Ms. Vaught has been named the South Carolina Aspirations in Computer Educator of the Year. The award publicly celebrates educators who encourage high school women's interest and participation in technology pursuits. Ms. Vaught is a computer science teacher and robotics team coach. She attended her first gender equity in computer science workshop in 1998 and has since worked to find ways to entice young women to participate in technology and engineering courses. She recently hosted a girl-powered event for 19 middle school young ladies who were able to hear and meet successful women in the industry. That's powerful and important work, Tammy. Congratulations. Louise Snipe, please come forward along with your principal, Andrew Barbone. Ms. Snipes has received the South Carolina Educational Office Professional of the Year Award. As you may know, this organization is near and dear to many of our office professionals. Richland, too, is well represented on the county, state, and national level. This award is well-deserved for Ms. Snipes and is based on her professional accomplishments, membership activities, and contributions to education. The criteria for judging included continuous professional growth, professional certification, professional ratings, office knowledge and skills, leadership, interpersonal relationships, and community activities. That's a lot of stuff. Mm-hmm. Woo! She now goes on to compete for the National Education Office Professional of the Year. I'm glad you get more awards, because that's a lot, which will be presented at the National Conference in Greenville this July, and our local chapter is very involved in hosting that national conference, which will have people from all over the country here. Congratulations. We're very proud of you, Ms. Snipes. Richland 2 hit the trifecta of awards from the South Carolina Council for Exceptional Children. Please come forward. Lonnie Beattie Principal Karen Beeman, Westwood High School teacher Sabrina Jensen and her principal Cheryl Guy, and Bridge Creek Resource teacher Lakita Lindsay, along with her principal Kristen Eubanks. Katina Davis, will you please join them as well? Katina is our Chief Officer for Instructional Support. The Council for Exceptional Children is a collaborative community of professionals who are the voice and vision of special education in South Carolina. Its mission is to improve the educational outcomes and qualities of life of exceptional children. Every year, the Council selects a Principal of the Year, a Teacher of the Year, and a Rookie Teacher of the Year with less than five years of experience who best represent its mission. These three ladies were bestowed the honor this year, and it says so much that from all over the state, this organization looked to Richland too for their top choices. We have had many winners through the years, and it makes us all proud that our district is a leader when it comes to special education. Karen Beeman received the Principal of the Year Award. Sabrina was the Teacher of the Year Award, and Lakita was the Rookie Teacher of the Year Award. And so let me make sure that's right. They give out three awards, and we got all three.
All right.
It doesn't get any better than that. Congratulations. Thank you. Our next recognition goes to Rebecca Watkins from the Center for Inquiry, and we'll ask her principal, Dr. Lynn Mueller, to come forward with her. Ms. Watkins is the first recipient of the R. Scott Hotman Award for the South Carolina Art Education Association. This award gives funds to SCAEA members to promote quality art education and student achievement through innovative instruction. Ms. Watkins' students worked with a visiting artist and the art teacher to create banners that incorporate third grade science standards, animals, and environment to be permanently displayed in the school's atrium. Congratulations, Ms. Watkins, for being an innovative art teacher and the first recipient of the award. All right. Several of our schools receive school-wide awards, and we get to recognize them right now. Round Top Elementary, as I'm sure many of you heard, won the coveted Palmetto's Finest Award from the South Carolina Association of School Administrators. We have their administrative team with us, and I'm going to make them come up, but they have also asked to officially receive the award. They would like their Teacher of the Year, Jesse Steedley, to come forward, as well as support person, staff member Fanny Lott, to come forward. Oh, evidently Fanny didn't know she was going to be called up. So Fanny and Jesse, come on up with your principal, Janine Tucker, assistant principals Clarissa Bennett and Will Moody. Jesse and Fanny are coming up because they are especially proud of having a perfect score of 100 in the category of instructional programs in the ratings for the Palmetto's Finest. Also, would all the, members of the Round Top staff, employees that are here, please stand as well. Hold tight, but don't go anywhere. This annual award recognizes educational innovation in South Carolina schools. Round Top was only one of five schools across the state to earn this recognition, and to win each school had to progress through an intensive application process requiring self-evaluation, peer review, and two on-site visits. And they learned it through a live stream, which was pretty awesome to watch. And we had several members, Dr. Elkins Johnson was there, and members of executive staff. I was watching actually through Twitter and saw it on Twitter. I was in a meeting and started screaming in the meeting that y'all had won. So, and everybody looked at me like I'd lost my mind. But anyways, it was a very exciting moment. The kids were jumping up and down, and you could see it in the video from Twitter. So congratulations, we're very proud of you. A few weeks before that big announcement, we received another big announcement about Richland Northeast High School and Spring Valley High School. They have been named National Magnet Schools of Distinction by the Magnet Schools of America. Please come forward from Richland Northeast, Principal Dr. Sabrina Suber, Dr. Sonia Merriweather Hawkins, who is our Magnet Director and IB Coordinator, and Assistant Principal Denise Fowler. And then from Spring Valley, Principal Jeff Timoney and Magnet Director Michelle Wyatt. This recognition is given to recognize the top magnet programs in the United States. To be selected, magnet schools must show commitment to high academic standards, curriculum innovation, successful diversity efforts, and consistent delivery of quality services. The schools are judged and scored on their ability to raise student academic achievement, promote racial and socioeconomic diversity, and create strong family and community partnerships that enhance the school's magnet themes. Both schools will be recognized for this achievement in Los Angeles next week. Oh, wow. Can I go?
Yeah.
Congratulations. Huh? Okay, I'll stay with you, Dr. Super. Congratulations, and thank you for your hard work, and y'all enjoy your trip. You deserve it. Fun. And another great announcement came for Sandlapper Elementary. Would Principal Linda Hall please come forward? San Lapper was named a Leader in Me Lighthouse School, and this was the first school in our district to achieve this status. Again, another momentous accomplishment. San Lapper implemented the Leader in Me process, which is a whole school transformation model that empowers students with the leadership and life skills they need to thrive in the 21st century. Only 267 schools worldwide have achieved the Lighthouse status. It's a rigorous process to become a Lighthouse school. San Lapper had to assemble a Lighthouse team, create a leadership environment, teach and reinforce the seven habits, work together collaboratively, involve parents, hold leadership events, and much more. The school has seen positive results, including clubs for every student, student-led showcases of academic learning, and a decrease in behavior referrals. And the best way to see the impact of this program is to go to their Leadership Day. I had the great pleasure of going to it, and it is wonderful. So y'all do that again next year, I hope, and they open it up to the community, and I highly recommend you go, even if you can only spend an hour or so with those kids. It is just amazing. So congratulations to San Lapper for the award, but for more importantly, for the transformation that you did and the hard work. I would like to call forward Westwood Principal Dr. Cheryl Guy and Athletic Director Jason Powell for this next recognition. I am happy to announce for the second time in 3 years, the Westwood High School Athletic Department has been awarded the South Carolina High School League Award of Excellence for exemplary display of sportsmanship, ethics, and integrity. The title says it all. There's a lot more than just winning for our Westwood athletes. And boy, I saw it the other weekend. Mm-hmm. Congratulations. Yep. Now, to enjoy all of these activities and accolades, you have to have money. And lucky for us, the department that keeps that going is pretty good, too. So would Dr. Harry Miley and his team come forward? Of course, Dr. Miley's over there timing me because he is itching to get up here and talk about the budget, so he wants me to get done. Dr. Miley has with him Shelley Allen and Penny Denini. The finance department works very hard, and tonight we recognize them for receiving two top awards for financial reporting and accountability. The first award is the Certificate of Excellence Award from the Association of School Business Officials International for having met or exceeded the program's high standards for financial reporting. The other award is a Certificate of Achievement from the Government Finance Officers Association of the United States and Canada. The certificate is the highest form of recognition in the area of the governmental accounting and financial reporting, and its attainment represents a significant accomplishment by the Richland II Finance Department. And certainly every year is an attainment, but when you've attained this award upwards of 30 years in a row, 30, we're getting 32, 30 something, 30 plus years in a row. But who's counting? Yeah. Who's counting? There's a wall with lots of... That says something. Yeah. So congratulations, and thank you for your diligence and hard work and giving us the money. Thank you for your patience while we recognize all those awards. Students, thank you while I butchered your names, but I hope you know that we love recognizing you, and this is the greatest time of the year for me.
We do. Thank you. I thought everybody was here for the budget.
We'll see in just a second.
Yeah. All right. Thank you very much for all those wonderful awards. Just another testament to the work that we do in our district. You talk about taking care of the whole child and how that's important to education. And when you look at arts and just special ed and all the different things that we talked about here today with Quiz Whiz and all of those things, I think it's a testament to the fact that we do that in Richland, too, for our students. And I appreciate the parents and everybody who helped to make this happen. It didn't just happen by itself without your support as well. So thank you all for what you do, making us look good and the hard work that's put into that. I have a lot of random facts I need to learn to get close to Quiz Whiz there. But thank y'all very much. Next on our agenda, we have the consent agenda. If I can have a motion.
So moved.
So moved by Mr. Plank. Do I have a second? Seconded by Dr. Caution Parker. Is there any discussion? With no discussion, we'll have the vote at this time. You didn't get a pop-up. Okay. Well, do you want to tell her how you're? Yeah. Did anybody else not get a pop-up? Everybody else good. Okay. Okay. Motion passes 7-0. Yeah, I noticed after everybody left, the rest of y'all are at the back of the room. All right. So next we have our legislative update, Mr. Plank.
Yes, Mr. Chair, and it's always interesting how everyone bolts right around the interesting topic of legislation. Again, our mission here and purpose for giving this update is to update the board and the public on pressing educational-related legislative issues that may have an impact on the way we do business here in Richland, too. The legislature was on recess last week, so we don't have, there really is no other update at this point. There'll be a touch on the state pensions element that Dr. Miley will bring up during the budget session. But unless you have any other questions related to what's up on the screen, there'll be no other update.
Okay, thank you. All right, next we have our public participation. Before we get started with that, I do want to remind folks that we do record this on YouTube, so it is out there in perpetuity. Also, just a reminder that when your name is in the record for this, it is public record. Just saying that because the media is here, and I know that they're interested in the folks who speak, just to make sure you're aware. So I have one person who has signed up, Ms. Deneen Rivers.
Greetings.
Greetings. Thank you.
Good evening, Chairman Manning, ladies and gentlemen of the school board.
Good evening.
Dr. Hamm, parents, and community members. I am Deneen Green Rivers, a Richland School District 2 parent, SIC member, and family advocate. I attended the board meeting on March the 28th to not only support some of our student presenters, but to learn more about the KI visitors policy proposal. I sat in disappointment and utter shock to learn that this great district in which I and other families invest our time, talents, and treasures has sought to limit visitation. The proposed policy opens with an open door statement, which says, "The board encourages parents and guardians to visit classrooms to observe the work of the school." Then it goes on to set restrictions that are not encouraging in any way. Richland, too, has prided itself on parent collaboration and engagement. On the district's website, it clearly welcomes parents by stating, "Richland, too, prides itself on the strong relationships it has with our families." According to Mr. Price, principals and teachers have decided that it is beneficial to limit observation of our children's classroom settings. This highly restrictive policy of when and how parents can visit severely hinders parent-teacher relations. Frankly, I am leery of schools that hinders full access to parents. Parents need to observe teachers and student interactions, see classroom setups, and examine effectiveness of instructional methods. Our children need to visibly see parents, teachers, and administrators working cohesively in the learning environment. This gravely affects families of children who have IEPs and 504 plans. These children are protected under the Individual with Disabilities Education Act, which is a federal law. This law provides rights and protections to not only children with disabilities, but their parents. These procedural safeguards allow parents to have a voice in the educational decisions of their child. Observation restrictions would not allow parents significant input on modifications and accommodations. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Superintendent Hamm, and Mr. Price, I urge you to go back to the drawing board and examine a better way to minimize disruption and keep parents, students, and faculty safe without restricting visitation. By celebrating unrestrictive open door policy, we empower parents to become active partners in the learning experience. Observation allows parents to witness students' success and aid in challenges so we can work together to close any gaps. Your vote against this policy will be a true testament of how strongly you truly value the input of parents and guardians.
Thank you, Ms. Rivers, very much for your comments.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yep. That's the only speaker that I have signed up. I know that there may be some interest on this topic. Because this is an item that's up not for a voting item tonight, to make sure that everybody has all the information before we continue to hear from parents and folks that are interested, if you want to sign up for the second public participation, please come forward. Is Ms. Is Georgette still here, Ms. Council? Okay, we'll make sure we get the list out if I can get somebody to handle the list to make sure if you want to speak, sign up for the second public participation and you'll have the opportunity to come forward then. So we will move on now to our next item, which is our executive session items where we're voting. If I can have a motion on student appeals, please.
Yes, Mr. Chair. On student number one, recommendation is to adult ed. Student number two, refer to the IEP team at Blythewood with Loretta.
Motion has been made by Mr. Plank. Do I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Dr. Elkins-Johnson. Is there any discussion? With no discussion, we'll have the vote at this time. And the motion passes 7-0. Will, are you the person they need to see if they want to sign up? So, yeah, person, young man in the back with his hand up. For if you want to sign up for the second public participation. Next on our agenda, we have item 10.3, a legal matter regarding selection of a legal firm. If I can please have a motion.
Yes, Mr. Chair. I'd like to make the motion that we hire the Duff Law Firm to represent the district.
Okay, motion's been made by Ms. Agostini. Do I have a second? Seconded by Dr. Caution Parker. Is there any discussion? With no discussion, we'll have the vote at this time. And motion passes 7-0. Thank you very much. Next on our agenda, we have our only action requested, old business action requested item, which is a policy of policy revisions to school board orientation goals and policy BAA, Dr. Hamm.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Policy BAA and BAA are policies that you received at your last meeting, have had an opportunity to review. We've received no requests for revisions and are recommending approval this evening.
All right. Can I have a motion? So moved by Ms. Mackey. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Dr. Caution Parker. Is there any discussion? I'm sorry. I do apologize, Dr. Elkins-Johnson. I get my doctors mixed up. Is there any discussion? No discussion. We'll have the vote at this time. Motion passes 7-0. Thank you very much. Next on our agenda is item 12.1, which is policy KI-K-R for visitors. This is old business with no action requested. Dr. Hamm.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, we're bringing this item as information for the board. As you know, in the past, we brought some recommendations to you that were intended to bring some consistency among how we handled visitors in our schools, as well as to ensure that class time wasn't interrupted. As we have worked through this process, we've received input from SIC members, we've heard from you as board members, we've talked to our Parent Advisory Council. And as a consequence of that, tonight we're recommending that we make no policy changes to KI, that we adopt policy KIR, that requires no action since it's just a regulation. That particular regulation would be new and provides basic information for visitors, for example, wearing identification badges, that public safety and security personnel would be exempted from going through our lobby guard procedure, as would routine school staff, has some requirements for ensuring that our students are picked up midday, are indeed picked up by authorized individuals, and some information about how we will handle dangerous and suspicious persons. That's what's in the regulation. Procedurally, there will be no requirement in our procedures for advance notice, but we will, as we do with all visitors, require parents to go through lobby guard, to wear a visitor sticker. They'll be escorted to the classroom, and when the visit is over, they'll be checking out through lobby guard. So that's the background information on that. It requires no action on the part of the board, and basically we are ensuring some consistency and have changed our previous recommendations to simplify them.
All right, board members, questions or comments?
Just a comment. Just want to say thank you to Dr. Hamm and to the district office for hearing our concerns and for making the right decision and the right choice by putting parents and students first, because it does take a village to raise our child. So thank you for hearing our concerns.
Thank you, Dr. Elkins-Johnson. Other comments or questions?
Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir. Ms. Shaw.
I would echo the sentiments of Dr. Elkins-Johnson. I thought this was the right decision to do, and I look forward to us moving forward as a community and as a family.
Thank you, Mr. Shad. Other comments? Yeah, thank you very much. I think this demonstrates the process works, right? Administration brought forward a recommendation. The board clearly had some concerns and questions, and so we worked through it, hearing from our community and the concerns of the board, and I think we ended up in a place where we're all very happy with the outcome. And so, again, just shows that the process does work the way it was designed to work. So just to be clear, that this is where we are with this. There will be no future board item or agenda item on this going forward at this time. Just to make that clear for everybody, that this is the final result from that discussion.
Just one comment.
Go ahead.
As we thank the parents who come and speak at public participation opportunities and things of that nature, but I want to thank also the parents who will email or call or text or Facebook or things of that nature. We hear your concerns, and so we always appreciate whatever mechanism you employ to contact us and to share your concerns. We appreciate that.
Mr. Chair, I'm sorry. I did want to recognize Ms. Rivers, who is my SIC president at Kelly Mill Middle School. Thank you so much for your comments and your time here today.
Okay. All right, did we get everybody? All right. Next on our agenda, new business, no action requested, 13.1, our favorite topic, the general fund budget for 2017-18. Dr. Miley.
I apologize for this being handled
received. As you know, this has been a pretty dynamic process. And it's been a dynamic process with information at the last minute. For instance, we got the information on property taxes yesterday afternoon from the county auditor. That's how late information was provided. Shelley and Penny have done a brilliant job getting this information together for us.
Thank you.
What you have, you will have in a couple minutes, is the presentation for tonight, a little background information on average increases over the last since 2012, and then a little bit more background information in terms of some millage calculations. All right, I'll go ahead and get started on the presentation. If you have any questions in terms of what information you have with you, we'll be referring back to some of that as we go through. I have it. I was asking Tony to go ahead and please advance this when I have it in my hand. it's hard to get good help, right? You know, just sorry. Just to be as quick as we possibly can, some of this information you have seen before. We have provided this for you, to you in work sessions and workshops. You know that we've gone through, and the public knows that we go through an extensive process of getting information and input from all stakeholders, from the board, get your priorities, we get it from the employees, we survey the employees, we had a very good response, one of the highest response rates in our employee survey. We go to departments, we go to the chiefs, the school levels, to get requests, to get information and input to the board, to the budget process. We've done that. We've vetted it through the senior staff. We've vetted it through the kitchen cabinet, and we have brought this to you tonight. We are on a little bit more accelerated schedule this year. We like to have had this information to you before, but due to the state's process, due to the county's auditor's information getting us too late, we're here. We also have to have it to the county council on May the 3rd, which has typically been about a week after that. But due to their county council sessions, we've had to speed that up. So we've crunched this down to about a two-week process. We have first reading tonight. We'll have second reading on May the 2nd. And then we submit it to the county by May the 3rd, the next day. So again, we'll be glad to answer any questions that you have. A couple of budget priorities that I wanted to mention, and again, some of you were at the board workshop, we talked about this, but these were some of your priorities, and I've listed the frequency in terms, we had many, many priorities from the board, but some of them were consistently mentioned by various board members. For instance, maintain, this is a consistent priority over since I've been here, certainly, is maintain low pupil-teacher ratios. Five of the board members mentioned that. Increase recruitment efforts to attract best teachers and administrators nationwide. Again, five board members mentioned that. And certainly there may be board members that didn't mention it, but certainly it may be a priority, but again, based on their input and feedback from us. Improve middle school achievement. That's been a high goal and priority. Maintain our fiscal responsibleness. That may not be a word, but maintain fiscal integrity. I make up new words, that's okay. And maintain a fund balance of 15. Our board policy, your board policy, is between 7% and 16.5%, and we've been maintaining that right about 15% since I've been here. You've built that up over the years. Develop and implement a foreign language program for elementary students. Again, that has come up again this year, and increased support for elementary literacy programs, and leadership mentoring and future leadership identification are all consistently mentioned by board members. We also asked, I'll try to be as brief as possible, but I want to point these out because we think they're important sources of input for the deliberation of what does end up in the budget. This was a summary from the employee staff survey, and this was provided to you in a board brief prior to this, but one of the things that was interesting is to see those areas that were really high priority, and obviously, employee compensation is always one that pops up. But a second one was student behavior support. That is emphasizing putting priority on student behavior support. Academic interventions, that's again, those are the RTIs and things like that, and reading coaches that we have. So some of the things that pop up in terms of those are some of the key priorities from our employees. Did you want to, I'm going to ask Shelley to help with some of the presentation, including some of the budget assumptions.
I won't go back through all of these assumptions. We went through a lot of this at our last meeting, April the 4th, I believe. Again, we're still assuming growth of around 350 new students next year. As you know, we're going to also be opening Jackson Creek Elementary, so we will have additional costs this year for opening a school, which we don't necessarily have every year, but there are quite a bit of operational costs that are involved in that. We are also assuming teacher salary schedule increase of just a step. At this point in time, the state has not proposed any additional increase to that, so we are including that as well. One of the things that has changed since our last meeting is we did get some updated projections from the county related to our value of a meal, which was really, honestly, one of the first really good pieces of news we've gotten related to the budget. So that value of a meal has gone up from what we were projecting, and above, just to put it in perspective, I think last year's budget number we worked from that the county had given us was like 290,500. So that's a nice little increase in the value of a meal based on those estimates. We've also assumed a 3.3% increase to the employer cost of health insurance. That increase is directly related to the premiums. And then we have an assumed 2% increase for the employer portion of the state retirement cost. I think mentioned earlier in the legislative, there will also be an increase for the employees as well. So they will see that increase from there with holdings also. To touch on the highlights and just get to the meat of it from our last meeting, what's changed, you'll see some numbers that have gotten better. And we've said from day one, and I'll go ahead and apologize if there are any errors in this. This is literally hot off the press. It's changing, you know, every minute we have some new piece of information. Part of what has changed, I think the last time we met, we knew that the Senate was bringing a higher base student cost. So we had already incorporated that into the figures that you saw at the April 4th meeting. The part we did not have any information on as far as dollars was the additional money that they were going to provide for the fringe benefits offset and any other changes Senate may have put in there. Once we got those projections, and of course it was several days after our last meeting, those numbers actually went up significantly, which was great. We got an additional $1.9 million for fringe benefit category. So as our delegation had indicated, they were going to fully fund the general fund portion of those salaries and that fringe increase, that is very close to what we're seeing. So that was really good news. And also the teacher salary supplement piece went up just slightly, $165,000. And then the other thing, as we talked about earlier, was the value of a meal and having those updated projections. And that generated about a little over $2 million. So the good news is we have more revenue than we anticipated, which is very, those of you who've been down this road, it's just the way it works. So in general, just looking at what options, the range of options that we would have to look at, with a zero mil increase, we would generate $272 million. With the full cap increase of 7.9 mils, we would generate $274,785. That's an additional $2.3 million if we were to request full cap of 7.9 versus zero mills. This breakdown is really, you guys have seen this before. This is more for the benefit of the public and for those that were not at our last meeting. But this is basically a diagram just showing how our general fund dollars are typically spent. And emphasizing that a huge portion of our budget is tied up in personnel costs, so 87.5%. And then you have property contracts of 3.2. A lot of that also includes our custodial services because we have outsourced that. Most districts would have that in their personnel cost, and so we actually have that in a contract. So that and utilities eats up a good portion of our budget, and that's just kind of a picture for everyone to see. just basically, this is our revenue projections at this point. A lot of what we just went through kind of highlights the big changes from last time, but as you can see, local property taxes look a lot better than they did last time. Additional $5.3 million projected. Property tax relief has stayed the same from last time, a little over $600,000. Our EFA is fairly in line with the Senate's new base student cost, which gave us an additional $85,000, I believe, per. And then the state fringe category went up quite a bit. So that was a huge benefit for us to help offset those costs on the expenditure side. Those are really the most significant changes. As you'll recall, you see a decrease of $1.1 million in the revenue for other sources, and that's related to the fact that we shifted out our early childhood program from the general fund and created a district-wide program using Title I funds. So the revenue will decrease and the corresponding expenditures will decrease. It'll basically be a wash in the general fund, but you'll see that on both sides related to that shift into Title I. So that's basically a picture of the revenue and where we are. And I'll let Harry talk about the expenditure piece of it, but if there's any questions about revenue.
And as you look at that revenue sheet of the $274 million, you see that the one, I don't think the red dot works, but the everything is determined at the state level, just about, except for the impact aid, indirect cost, interest income. Those are relatively minor. Again, I don't mean to imply that $150,000 is minor, but in a $270 million budget, $150,000 does not make a whole lot of difference. The big numbers are from the state in terms of the EFA. Fringe benefits this year is a huge portion, and the property tax relief of Act 388. The one number that's there as Shelley mentioned, has really changed since the last time we talked was the property taxes, which is due to the increase in the mill value that we got from the auditor. We were very pleased with that. We were hoping that that was the case, but until the auditor issues that information, it's not official. On the expenditure side, we've given you a little bit more detail to give you an idea, and you may not be able to read that from the screen. It is in your handout. You may still need some reading glasses to read it. But we thought, and we certainly can answer questions later on, but we thought we'd give you a little bit more information to what's included in some of these categories, because some of the time the title alone does not always give you a full indication of what is covered there. But as you see, the total increase of our budget is estimated to be 5.33% over last year's budget, an increase of $13.9 million. The largest portion, $5.4 million, is in salaries and benefits. That increase is due to not only the increased raise of the step increase, but of additional employees, which we have on the books we proposed in this budget. Benefits, as you see, is a huge portion that's driven by the new requirement for the pension fund of 2 additional percentage points. That's a driver there that we wouldn't normally see in terms of the increase in benefit costs. But again, I know that you may think I was crying wolf, but a month ago we weren't sure that the state was going to provide us the funding directly for that employer contribution. We knew that we were going to have to pay it, so we knew the expenditure was going to be there, but until about a week or so ago, we weren't sure that the revenues were going to be there. So we are very happy that the state did decide to fund. It may not fund all of that liability on our part, but it will fund the majority of that, which is a great benefit to the district. I know you can't read that on the screen, but if you have any questions, we have one more page here that may give you more detail in terms of the incremental increases and the new line items that we are suggesting and requesting in the budget. We are suggesting that we ask for a mill cap of 7.9 mills. That provides us additional estimated $13.9 million. And the list you see on that budget page lists the items that we're proposing to increase. The highlights of that item are one of the things you see in the red, that's the reduced expenditures required for the Child Development Center that now are paid for Title I money. You saw the offsetting decrease in revenues on the revenue side. Here's the offsetting reduction in the expenditures for that program. We are reallocating two FTEs, which is two teacher growth FTEs, which is a reduction of two FTEs. Some of the highlights are Jackson Creek opening. Our estimate right now is that that will cost us $1.9 million to open Jackson Creek. That's a biggie in this budget. We also have an estimated 16 teachers for FTEs for growth. If you remember, our estimated growth in students is 350 new students. We base that estimate on new growth positions of our roughly 20-to-1 student-teacher ratio. That's 17 and a half positions. We think 16 is adequate. Some of the other highlights, we have four special ed teachers. I think Catania could use a couple of dozen in terms of special ed teachers, but we are bumping up against some guideline ratios in terms of number of workloads, caseloads, and number of FTEs. So we need to add additional FTEs for special ed assistants. We have six special ed teaching assistants. Some of the other highlights that that I'll point out, about 3 years ago, the middle school principals came and said we needed interventionists at the middle schools to identify kids that need special attention in terms of achievement. They wanted 14 FTEs at the time. We started an implementation program which we phased that in two or three a year. We're suggesting and requesting three FTEs for those RTIs interventionists. They're not RTIs at the middle school. They're called something else, but you get my drift. But three to finish that rotation and phase in where every school would have one interventionist at their discretion. They would decide whether it would be a math or language arts person, but they would, that way we would have one at all middle schools. We thought about stretching out one more year to phase it in, but this way we can phase it in and all the middle schools will have it. Again, we're also asking for three FTEs for elementary RTIs. This would be the third year of that phase in to get RTIs at all the middle school, elementary schools. That's three FTEs in this budget. Most of the other requests are usually one FTE here, one FTE there, funding for various things. I think if there's a question, I may ask some of our academic folks to help me, but there is a great concern, and I'm sure I will mess this up, but there is a great concern at the elementary level for our curriculum, and that we want to have, and Debbie may be able to help me here too, but in terms of our curriculum needs, the current system we're using, we don't think is adequate, and we want to shift over to what's called an open court system. Am I butchering that pretty badly? And that's a really high need. The full cost is from K to the second grade is over $1 million, but we think that we could phase that in with I believe, the kindergarten first, and that was represented by that $335,000 for this curriculum, but apparently it is what the district needs in terms of that curriculum for reading at the elementary level. Other than that, another item that you may see that's relatively large compared to most budget years since I've been here is for contracts. We have gone out on bid for, as required, in fact, you allowed us to extend them by 1 year last year, but we've gone out on bid for both our custodial services and our landscaping services. They were both due for rebid this year. Both are coming back with, we included in the RFPs for additional services. We are concerned and we hear from principals and we've listened to them in terms of the service levels from our custodial services, and so we've increased the requirements on those custodial service contracts. In addition, we have this facility, and this time next year we'll have Jackson Creek, so we have more facilities, more grounds, more hallways, et cetera, to service. In addition, we're asking for increased levels of service also at all sites and for summer coverage. So those contracts are going to be more expensive this year, partly because of our request to increase the level of service. So that's one of the reasons. I just want to make sure that that's a larger number than we would normally see in terms of an incremental cost to our contracts, but I just wanted to explain to you why that is so large this year. I'll be glad to go through every line item and refer any question to the appropriate person if you have any questions. Again, this is first reading. We'll have second reading on May the 2nd and then submit it to the county council the next day.
Okay, I don't want to put anybody on the spot, but I think because probably a lot of us are going to have comments on this issue, do y'all mind if I start with Dr. Elkins-Johnson and then kind of work my way? You don't have to speak, but if we'll go in that order, that'll, instead of me just randomly selecting folks. Dr. Elkins-Johnson.
Okay, thank you for presenting the budget to us. I wish we had gotten it earlier, but I know Shelley just said it's fresh off the press, so I truly understand that, so I had to quickly go through it. Just a few questions, if you can explain. The first one is the school resource officer contract increase. I notice every year since I've been on the board, and let me just say this, I know, first of all, safety is our number one priority. But I notice every year since I've been on the board is always a school resource officer contract increase. Can you explain that for me? And if you can tell me how much it costs to have an officer in each one of our schools, what are we paying for that?
I can, not off the top of my head. I believe last year I think last year they first asked us for an increase of something like $220,000. And in fact, Mr. Plank met with the sheriff. We got that down, I believe, to about 100, if I remember right. At that time, we did an analysis, and we negotiated with them. And one, you're right, we have had an increase. The very first year I was here, I went over to complain. Mm-hmm. Everybody in the room had a gun but me. And it's very difficult to negotiate. So, you know, you lose that. I'm sorry. I learned a real good lesson that day. But we understand that the sheriff has cost increases just like us. And they have employer contribution increases. They have salary increases. They have other increases. So we understand that. We did analysis, and I didn't do it this year, and I'll be glad to do it. Mm-hmm. But last year, and is the sheriff here? Last year, our per SRO contract was the least of any district that Sheriff Lott serves. So we felt like we had a pretty good contract with the sheriff's office because our per unit SRO cost mm-hmm. was less than Lexington 5 or Lexington 1's. So we felt like we didn't have a whole lot of room to go argue when we were actually in better shape than any other district that the sheriff provided SROs. But we think we work with them very closely. I know that Cleve works with the sheriff's office closely. I think that there's a limit, and when they asked for too much last year, we actually just complained a lot, and we asked them to explain it, and they did. We got them to come off. We felt like this year, with the level of service, that we felt like that was within reason, given that we also know he's been being hit with the same 2% employer contribution that we are and other costs.
I think theirs is larger, isn't it?
It probably is larger.
Theirs had a bigger increase.
And I don't know whether they're getting state funds or not for that, but that's we feel like it's a cost of doing business.
Yeah, thank you for that, but I'm not sure if you still answered my question as to how much it costs to have.
I don't have that on the top of my list.
Okay, if you can get that for me.
Yes, I will be glad to do that.
And
it's
also,
around $36,000, I think.
Per officer?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, if you can find that out, the correct number for me.
Higher.
Right, if we can get the correct figure, that would be great. And also, have we looked at other options if we chose not to use Richland County Sheriff's Department? Have we looked at other avenues of different security guards or city police or something like that?
You know, we started looking at that last year when we were talking, or the year before when we were talking about doing away with SROs, and we started thinking about that, and we got the clear message that we wanted SROs.
No, that wasn't my question, to do away, just to find other options if we decided not to use.
Well, I mean, we did start looking at other options at that time. We have not looked at other options since.
I would love us to compare the costs if we have time to do that, to look at other options as well. And then before you said that Mr. Plank went and negotiated the contract and we were able to come down to
$100,000. No, he did not negotiate a contract. He so went with us to help talk to the sheriff's office.
Okay, and then that lowered the amount by $100,000, correct?
I can't remember the exact numbers, but it lowered it quite a bit.
So I'd love to know if Dr. Davis or Dr. Hamm is going to have that same conversation so we can lower that to use the other funds maybe towards some different things that we may need in the district. I'd love to hear about that conversation. Okay, my next question is, we talked about the new reading curriculum, open court. Do we no longer use open court? I know when I was a teacher, which was a while back in 2005, 2006, we used open court. So we no longer use open court.
Correct.
So we're going back to open court. What do we use now? So we're leaving treasures to go back to open court. Okay. And my final question was, I looked at and it said increase administrative support at CFI. Have we looked also at CFA to see if they need that same increased administrative support?
I believe we have. I think we discussed the needs there, and they weren't as acute as for CFI, if I remember correctly.
So CFA principal shared that she didn't need administrative support?
Can we...
There is one for C.
Okay.
CFI and CFA.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. Thank you for clarifying it.
Okay.
That's all I have.
All right, Ms. Agostini.
I'd just like to thank you for your work. And I am still trying to digest this information as being a new board member. So I am going to let Mr. Plank take my time with his questions, as I know he'll use the time wisely.
Oh, I overrule that. I don't. He doesn't get extra time. He gets his normal allotment. Ms.
Well,
Mackey.
And we do apologize. A lot of this information was available. You know, some of this is the same stuff we talked about on the 4th, but a lot of it's new. Some of the numbers have changed. So we apologize. But when we get the information yesterday, it's tough. But they, Shelley and Penny, have just done a great job. So they've really worked hard to get us to this point tonight.
Yeah. Ms. Mackey.
First and foremost, thank you for the work that goes into this, and the fresher it is off the press, we know the more accurate it is, so I appreciate that. I know Ways and Means is meeting all of this week. The last few years, for as long as I can remember, the governor's veto message has vetoed the student pupil cost, and it's typically overridden by the House and Senate. Do we have any idea if she's going to veto that again?
She or he?
He, I'm
it's
sorry.
It's not a she.
I'm sorry, he.
I have no idea.
Okay. Just wondering with a veto message. With regard to custodial and landscaping services, that increase is because we're going to need a larger amount of them. Is that
well,
more
we
facilities
have
a, to service? Is that what
yes,
I understood?
Yes, ma'am. It's an increased level of service.
Okay.
We may, when we get in the room, be able to get that down.
That's fine.
But
just clarify.
Right now, that's a good working estimate.
Okay. And I know we have budget constraints, as we do all the time, but I'm glad to see that we're still trying to work in the bus driver incentive pilot program.
Yes, ma'am.
Coaching supplements, I think that's something that we're going to, you know, it's iffy. We're going to see about that, the coaching supplements.
It's at the very bottom.
Yeah, I see it there.
It's another increment. It's
and
not,
we talked about having, you know, increments as it was available, but that's something that we're still trying to prioritize
yes, ma'am.
If we're able to.
Yes, ma'am.
And finally, just want to know, I know that we have to, you know, prioritize, but I wanted to appreciate that, you know, we're able to try to still get in support services, psychologists and sociologists and things of that nature. I know we talk about academics being fundamental, and that's inherent to students who need those services. So I appreciate that we're still trying to prioritize those services that we need as we're able to, because that is directly tied to academic performance for a large population. So I appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank them.
Yes. Thank you.
Crunched the numbers.
All right, Dr. Caution Parker.
Thank you all.
I'm just chomping at the bit
thank
here.
You.
Mr.
Thank
Plank.
You.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Miley, for putting this together so quickly. I know it just a lot of these numbers you got yesterday. I want to focus on the revenue side for a second. When we met prior, I understand these numbers are fluid and you're trying to make the best you can, especially prior to getting the auditor numbers. What was the difference? Remind me the amount with the full cap of 7.9 when we were based on our projections versus now that the adjustments have come in. Is that about, weren't we around $9, $10 million? It was around 3.8% increase, if I remember correctly.
It was. I believe the working estimate we had at the board workshop was about 12.
12, okay.
2.3 less than what's on here.
Yeah.
$2.3 million less.
3.5, so
okay.
13.9 minus
okay. All right.
I think it was about 2.5 if we went into mill cap at that point.
So our projections at that time were based on roughly a revenue max mill increase at that time over prior year's budget of slightly below 4%, if I remember correctly.
Correct.
Looking at the averages now, so the increase came from the mill value increase, and that has increased the amount. So now if we go with a 0% mill increase, based on my math, that comes to about a 4.42% increase if we looked at a zero mill.
Zero mill increase would be going from our current budget of 260.9 to 272.4, correct.
Which is about a little less than 4.5%.
Yes.
And going with the 7.9, full max is 5.8. And I just bring that up because, you know, we want to look at how our trends are going over, pardon?
5.3,
excuse me. Don't have my glasses on. Let me see. 5.3. Is it possible to get the expenditures with the zero mill increase line and then a 4.0 mill increase line?
We certainly can do that. What we have brought you is what the administration recommends. If we can certainly, we have not prioritized this list. All of these are priority in terms of, there's another $6 or $8 million that's on the floor from the cutting, mm-hmm. in terms that didn't get funded. Mm-hmm. So these were the priority items. Mm-hmm. These items aren't necessarily in priority order. So if we were instructed to say, instead of 13.9 million, 12 million, then we wouldn't want to draw a line on this page because
these aren't reflecting
the administration's priorities relative to the other $6 million that didn't get funded and didn't get requested.
Sure.
But in terms of that list, that's not in priority order. So we could certainly do that.
If we were looking at the budget as though we were going to be faced with a zero mill increase, it would be interesting to me to know what would be the expenditure priority at that point and then also at a midway point at 4%. I think that would just be helpful. As it relates to the revenue on the state pensions element, this, because of the recent changes, we're hoping that we'll get close to 100% of that revenue?
Probably won't be 100, probably be more like 80 or 90 maybe percent.
Okay.
But, you know, it started out we were going to get zero. Yeah. So, I mean, that was our fear at the time, which they weren't, and the legislature wasn't talking about. Fortunately, it got up to half of it, you know, remember?
Yeah.
The 1%, yeah. And then it's crept up to almost, we think maybe we'll be short $300,000 or $400,000.
So that's a benefit to us, and that's been incorporated, yes, into the budget numbers,
correct,
here, right?
That's reflected on the revenue side,
on the revenue
and
side,
on the expenditure side.
So what does it look like next year when, because this is an increasing percentage until a certain cap, right? Isn't that the way the legislation
is? It's going to go up another percent next year.
Another percent. Yes. So if we're adding this in now based on getting 80, 90%, next year, would that 1% be funded fully by us at that point?
Well, who knows? But one way to look at this, and I would encourage you to think this through, is if the legislature wasn't requiring us to do a 2 percentage point increase, for instance, last year we had a 0.5% increase in the employer contribution. The 5.3% increase would be much lower. That is, part of this 5.3% increase is being mandated by the state, and also funded by the state, mm-hmm, also. Mm-hmm. A lot of it is. Mm-hmm. So, again,
everything
putting it in perspective to prior years, part of this 5.3% increase, which is less than our average for the last 5 or 6 years, but still it's larger than one would perhaps might think. Part of that 5.3% is being mandated by the state and also fortunately being funded by the state, but it's still reflected in our total budget request.
Right.
So, you know, that skews things a little bit in terms of increases that the administration is recommending. You know, we didn't recommend that 2 percentage point, right. I'll guarantee you. So, but that's part of this budget. And it does, and I don't want to use the word inflate, but it does increase that total expenditure amount above what it might normally be in terms of our budget request.
Yeah, and I appreciate that. I guess the thing I want to explore a bit as I ask about the 0 and the 4% or 4 mills is, when we originally had the budget meeting, we based it on projections that were about $2 million less than what we expected, and we're able to develop a budget and priorities based on that revenue. And then we are now, the good news is we have received more revenue that wasn't necessarily expected. We naturally move into just adding more things to on the expenditure side to take up that increase. I want to look at, you know, if we've prioritized based on a certain cent dollar amount, and now the dollar amount more, does it automatically mean that we just shift it over and find things to spend on it at that point?
Well,
and please understand me as a public, I'm for the funding of education. I'm for making sure that we're taking care of all these programs, and at the same time, wanting to make sure we balance that with good stewardship as well.
So. And I appreciate that, and maybe this will help. On April the 4th, when we were thinking it was, you know, really rough, we still had $18 million worth of requests from all these people and all these departments. They didn't request more money when we found more money coming from the state.
Right.
There were $18 million worth of requests in March. And so I was having to get my no button out, and there was no money.
Right.
So I think, and I agree, I understand, oh, you found more money, therefore you found more things to pay for. We had a list of $18 million
right.
in March that we had no money for.
Sure.
And so I think what I think is natural for the folks in this room is we need 12 teachers. We got money for 4. Let's get 4. Oh, wait, we needed 12 and we got money for 8. Let's get 8 because we need 12.
Sure.
So I think part of the process is that in terms of understanding why we could go from this dire budget of no money in 1st of April to saying, oh, we've got extra money and, oh, we'll find things to spend it for. I think it's the things that were in line to spend things on were there in March, and it was $18 million and we had no money.
Right.
There were going to be a lot of disappointed people.
Yeah, just move the line down to capture more items
that we need.
A couple, just 2 other quick things related to that. I don't know if you recall or not, but one of the things that we brought up when we presented that sheet that had the lines was that this was just really to give you a picture of what it looked like.
Yeah.
At that point, we had not gone through and really vetted to determine and bring what we felt like really the district needed. So that's one thing I just wanted to remind everyone. The other thing is,
Shelly, will you come up to the mic since we have the audio?
I thought I was plenty loud enough.
You are for us.
Sorry.
I think she's just going to take it here on out.
No. But another thing to think about, at that point, we also didn't know what was going to happen on the retirement side, the expense side. So if you went and looked back, we only had $1.6 million in there for that increase. We only had 1% because at that point, we thought PIBA was going to get the funding and it was somehow going to be netted.
Right.
We weren't sure how that was going to look.
Sure.
But the expenditures were, in fact, lower, even on that just picture for you guys, than they are now, too. So that's a couple of the things that I think drive that. I totally understand what you're saying, but just to put that perspective, those are some of the things you might want to think about in looking back at that.
No, I appreciate it. Thank you.
All right. Dr. Caution Parker.
Thank you. Really a comment and a question. I am really, really thrilled to see Open Court. I am thrilled to see Open Court back in. That was such a fine program, a successful program, phonics-based program for all of our students. And I remember when I was principal at Forest Lake Elementary, I implemented it there. the teachers kicking and screaming, and within 6 months, they just loved it. And our children really benefit from that program, so I'm glad to see it back. The other thing I want to ask about, this FTE, one FTE for a district fine arts coordinator, that's a new position?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, who's handling it now? How's it being handled now? Okay, so that will be taking some responsibility away from her?
It would. Actually, we have liaisons that she works with in each of those content areas. So, okay. Yes.
All right, that's all I have.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Shad.
Thank you, Ms. Chair. Dr. Miley and staff, I am very impressed that you all were able to, for the most part, address the input from stakeholders, specifically the board, and y'all have done a fabulous job, especially with the pupil-teacher ratio, anticipating the growth that we're going to have.
That's not the finance department. That's the group effort by senior staff and cabinet and everybody else, but we...
Right, but indirectly you say yay or nay by putting these numbers down, right?
I know it's my fault when things go wrong. I got that. I know that.
We'll blame you. Just kidding.
Yeah.
All right. But recruitment nationwide for to recruit talent into the district, I don't see that in here unless I'm missing it. Is that an item that we have? Now, I see marketing and advertising for the district, but that's about $30,000. But I don't see that in this item. Is that one of the things that hit the cutting room floor?
No, I don't. Thank you. Yeah. Sean's going to address that.
Thank you. There's other funds that can be allocated for recruitment that I'm working, that's out of a Title II fund that's allocated for recruitment and retention. So I requested from Nancy, and we're going to work together to pull money out of that so that way it doesn't impact the general fund.
Okay. Thank you.
In fact, there were several of that $18 million. I don't remember them, but there were several items in fact that we found that said, well, wait a minute, this is a priority, but it can be funded through some other source, through a grant or something like that. So
okay.
And
lastly, I'll just say that I appreciate the response for special needs as well as our math and ELA intervention. Thank you.
All right. Dr. Miley, the as it relates to the increase in fringe benefits with the increase in our retirement, is that increase that you're showing here reflected in the increase in salaries that are being projected? Does that make sense? So you're increasing salaries is the increase that you're showing. Where does the fringe get included in that?
Is this employer contribution based on this salary base or the next year's salary base?
The line item for the fringe is based on 2% to the existing salaries. Then the salary increase line item is just based on the actual schedule step piece. Does that make sense?
So would the
benefits line is only related to the increase, not necessarily the increase in salary costs that will drive an additional increase.
So I guess I'm asking, is that reflected somewhere though in these numbers? So that's in the salary increase. You include the fringe in that, as it would relate to the higher fringe.
That salary
cost.
Increase does have the fringe related to the salary.
The new fringe. Okay. Exactly. All right. So what's the percent increase that we have here? We have one for certified and one for classified. What percent increase is that?
The step, they average about 2%.
Right.
Some steps are different. Some steps are 0.5%, some are 1.5, 1.02, 1.8. So they're about 2% on all the salary schedules. They average about 2%.
Okay. So if I were to take the, I understand step is probably going to be in state requirement, so we don't really have much of a choice for our certified staff.
Correct.
For our classified staff, if I was to take that number and cut it in half, that would be about a 1% increase then?
About. If we took the estimate for certified staff, the 1.5, and if we said instead of a roughly 2% increase, we only gave them a 1% increase, we could cut that in about half.
Yes.
Correct.
Okay. I just want to remind.
The state's mandate.
Cannot.
That's right, and that's why I said classified, not certified. And I hate that that's taken out of our control, but it is, right? I don't have the ability to control all of that. I guess the thing that I would like for board members to think about is, because we know every year we're going to have an increase in fringe, that every percent we give this year is going to be have somewhat of a multiplier effect over time to accommodate for that increase. So we just need to think a little bit towards the future for what that means if we increase it today.
I will tell you, just because this is something we've talked about as well, that comes up in conversation, where could we look at? One of the things that ties in with recruitment is if we do not give classified folks their step, we're not talking about a increase to the salary schedule. We're talking about maintaining our salary schedule and a person shifting a year experience. If we don't give that step and we give less or none, then what happens is that salary schedule basically rolls back, and we're taking a step back from a recruitment standpoint. And so that's one of the things we've discussed as we've gone through that. So it may not appear that there's anything specifically tied to recruitment, but that's one of the things we have to consider. Because we literally, and we've done it in the past, we literally would have to roll back that schedule because somebody at this year experience isn't going to go up, so we have to shift that whole schedule down to keep them where they are.
Well, I think that, you know, in my comment to that is, right now, if we were to accept this budget today, I'm at 7.9. We already know that there's some unknowns in this budget, right? We don't know exactly what we're going to get for fringe. We don't know exactly a number of things. And that gives us absolutely no room for that to come in over, right? I mean, I know there's a little bit of flexibility here, but not a lot in all of this. And when I think when we look at the needs and some of the additional positions with opening up Jackson Creek and looking at continuing to increase the utilization of this building with a math teacher here and the other positions that we've got, certainly special ed needs, you know, we are pushing up. We have been for years, and we haven't fully funded that with the number of staff that y'all have been requesting for years. I think we need to give ourselves a little bit of breathing room in this budget for some of those issues. A little, not quite where Mr. Plank is halfway, but a little bit of breathing room somewhere in there. And, you know, I do understand the employees. You know, I also understand, though, you know, when we look at state employees, I mean, state employees haven't had but, like, really one significant increase over the last 10 years, no cost of living increase whatsoever, and this year there's no money for them. So, you know, if we look at even a 1% increase, I understand that might not be perfect and not exactly what we want, but that would significantly impact our number, our millage. If I calculated it right, if we took that line item out, that would be about 4.5 mils. So if we cut that in half, you're looking at about a two and a half mil decrease, which will put us slightly towards where Mr. Plank wants to be, with a little bit of breathing room. And I mean, we're going to have to make some tough decisions. I mean, you know, maybe there's some other things we can look at in here, but you know, some of these things have been asked for year after year, and we just haven't done it. And so, to me, that's something that I want to take a look at. And, you know, that's a painful item to talk about, but it is a place where I think we might need to flex a little bit, especially knowing that multiplier effect that's coming in, right? So as we add these positions that we're looking at adding, that again is going to increase our fringe costs going forward. As we look at pay increases, that, right? So that 1% increase multiplies every time we add a position, every time we increase salary, and we can't neglect that in our discussion as we look to the future and where we're going. So for me, that's something that I would like to have some consideration of, to look at maybe a 1%, not a 2%, where we have the control to do it.
Okay.
All right, any other question? And now, the only thing I would ask Dr. Miley, I know we have a number of requests for y'all to do. And you said May 3rd we have to?
We have to present. Our county council is requiring us to submit on May the 3rd, which is the day after our next board meeting.
Okay, so what I will ask is, some of the requests that we've asked you guys for, where it's going to take time to do some things, if that's just not possible right now because of that. I mean, that is the shortest we've ever had to get this level of detail and make a decision in the 6 years I've been on the board. So if you can't do it, please tell us, you know, that it's just not feasible to get that done, or, you know, you just can't work it out. Not to say we don't still have the discussion for maybe future years or time, but we're compressed. And I want to make sure we're respecting the ability to get all this done in that time.
I appreciate that. We will
let
you know.
If board members can work with me on that request, that if we're just asking something that's impossible, that we just realize that.
I know we have the questions down, and we'll let you know if we are not able to adequately address those questions in a timely manner.
Okay. I do appreciate that. And you're also pretty confident in the numbers we got from the auditor this year. Like, we're not in disagreement again over what that...
We have taken his numbers and said they're perfect.
We just took his numbers
we've seen in a long time. So.
Okay.
So we don't expect any discussion at the county council time unless, one, they walked in and lowered the number, which
they are projections and estimates.
But since I've been here, he's never lowered the number. He has increased the number at county council.
Just one other thing that the board needs to think about. You know, we've done this both ways over time. One is to present the actual millage rate and then kind of, you know, take a potluck, whether we get a little less or a little more, or we present as an actual number. And both ways have their drawbacks and potential pitfalls, but we need to make that decision going into this fairly quickly.
Yes.
So just a couple things for us to think
about.
Well, thank y'all. All right, other questions? Yeah. Thank y'all very much. Thank you, Dr. Miley. Thank you, staff. Always a tough process. All right, next we have a report on Kate, item 13.2, Dr. Hamm.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mary Page Boyce is going to be presenting the report on our career and technical education programs.
Welcome.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Members of the board, Dr. Hamm, Executive Board. Nice to be here this evening. And now for the good news. We've talked about the money, and now we get to talk about the fun stuff. So career and technical education in Richland 2. What exactly is CATE? We just use that to shorten it. But CATE provides students with academic and technical skills, knowledge, and training necessary to succeed in future careers and to become lifelong learners. And since I have been here, I've sort of adopted a slogan when people tell me, but my child's going to college, I say, to have a career. So CATE is valid in everyone's life. I wanted to briefly go over our current programs that we have in our schools, and I've tried to say in how many schools we have them. And the number out to the right is the number, I have pulled the number of Richland 2 8th through 12th graders who meet with their guidance counselors every spring, and they have an individual graduation plan, at which point they are asked, what is your intended field that you would like to go into after your education is finished? And so the number out to the right reflects the number of students in our 8th through 12th grade who have reported that field as their interest area. So you can see why we have health science and sports medicine at all five high schools, and why we started Med 2. Thank you for that last year during this hard budget process. It is also mirrored at the state level, by the way. That is the number one requested career area all over the state. But it is a significant high one here in our district. We have business administration classes at all of the schools. We have engineering at four of the five high schools and IT at all high schools. Printing, graphics, design, some of that varies. At some schools it's digital art and design, at some it's graphics and communications, but we have that at three of the five high schools. Culinary arts and hospitality, three of our five high schools, and here at R2I2 in the entrepreneurship with the culinary combined. And we have fire and emergency management at one school. I've listed a number there, 967. That represents a larger group that identifies law and security as well as emergency services as their area of interest. Agricultural programming, we have at one high school, and cosmetology and barbering, two high schools, construction, two high schools, and automotive at one high school. Based on the numbers that we see with student interest and areas that we don't have current programs and areas where we see reports that I go over lots of times during the year from the Department of Employment and Workforce, the Central Midlands Council of Government, et cetera, and the cost feasibility of adding new programs, these two here with a criminal justice program or a law program, and then an education and training program. I heard you all speaking about recruiting and retaining teachers. That would certainly be a great way to help us do that, to grow our own teachers. These two areas are very promising for future growth for Kate. And I briefly wanted to tell you some of the great celebrations that we have had this year. First of all, the high school competition teams, these are our student organizations, like HOSA and DECA and FBLA and Skills USA. We are really very proud for the second year in a row. We have a student team who has advanced to national competition, which will take place this summer, from all five high schools. We have been doing that now for 2 years in a row, that we've had literally someone or some team from all five high schools who win at the state level and get to go to national to compete. Industry recognized credentials. This is the big thing in the Kate world now. We are now having to report this instead of the number of completers on our end of the year report. How many credentials are kids leaving school with? Because, you know, now they're saying credential stacking is just very important in someone's life. And happy to report that 2 years ago we gave out 75, last year we gave out 94, this year we've given out 150 credentials, and we are going to be way over that next year, which I'm very excited about when we take the count from this current year. We opened a new program this year under health sciences. In your written report, I gave you, because of that high number of 2,400 plus kids that are interested in health science, we have numerous programs under that: sports medicine, the CNA program, farm tech. But we added this year two high schools, medical billing and coding as well, which is a great credentialing program. Through our CAT grant, we have been able to feature a great mentoring program, bringing in members of our community in the IT and engineering field to meet in very small groups. Typically, it's a mentor and two students. And that has just been a great experience for our CAT grant students at Ridgeview and Westwood. We did launch Med2. As you recall, last year, that was one of the things that you funded. And we have had wonderful success with that program. We've had over 250 kids who have voluntarily and for no credit attended nighttime seminars just because of their level of interest in that field. And we have 17 kids who are taking a nighttime and evening class with us in the rehabilitative areas. So it's just really been an amazing experience. This year, I'm proud of our students. We have met all Perkins performance measures, meaning the Kate students met all expected academic performance in math, reading, and in the graduation rate. So we had no improvement plan in any way for any of our academic attainment in Kate. We are excited to announce that next year, our CAT grant will bring the very first dual enrollment course to our district in the Kate areas, and we are going to bring in Claflin University, and they are going to offer IT, the college level IT course to our students in the CAT grant, and they are also going to offer a logic class, which is a systems kind of logic for the engineering students.
Very good.
And of course, at Richland Northeast, you all know about the Safe Federal Credit Union, and they debuted this year a debit card featuring the Cavalier logo. So we've had great success and great stories in all of our high schools that we're very excited about. I do have three stars of my report for you all to meet tonight. And they just represent, come on up, Devin, you're going to be the first. They represent wonderful student examples of Kate in our schools, and I really wanted you to hear from them what Kate means to them in their life at school and hopefully what it will mean in their life after high school. This is Devin Holder from Ridgeview High School.
Well, I'm the DECA chapter president of Ridgeview High School and future business leader of America chapter president of Ridgeview as well. I'm heavily involved in the CAPE programs, like mainly the health science programs. I took health science 1 last year. This year I'm taking health science 2, health science 3 online, and I'm in the new med 2 classes. And I'm doing clinical studies, and I'm working to get my CNA. And with my CNA, I can work in long-term care, home health, or acute care. And it's a really good opportunity, and I think more male students should take advantage of it because right now, I'm the only boy in my class, so obviously a lot of males ain't taking too much of advantage for the opportunities in the health science field, so I think we should get our school counselors to really talk about it to our male students who are interested in the medical field.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And as you heard, Devin is very involved in Kate, which we are thrilled about. And he is right. We do have a few other male students in CNA, but I wanted him to speak because it is so valid for everybody. He probably does not want to spend, I don't think he's going to spend his life and career being a CNA. He's using that as credential stacking. He's going to use that as experience to become something else. Next is Colin Busby from Blythewood High School.
So I just wanted to speak a little bit about what Kate's done for me at Blythewood. I'm currently a senior at Blythewood, and I started freshman year, wasn't really sure what I wanted to do. And so my mom was kind of pushing me in the health science direction. I was like, okay. And so I started taking my health science classes. I got through health science 2, and now I'm in medical terminology and billing and coding, and farm tech. It's hard to keep up with them. I'm taking so many. So I have a few certifications at the end of the year. And so it's just really done a lot for me. I didn't really know. I came in not really knowing what I wanted to do. And now I've been accepted into the early assurance program at PC. So into the pharmacy school. So it's really exciting.
And I do want everybody to know that not everybody who gets to go to the pharmacy school at PC gets the early assurance acceptance. That is probably because of his health science work that he does not have to apply after time at PC. Come up here. I also wanted to tell y'all one more thing. I'm sure he'll be being recognized by Libby later in May, but we found out tonight at 5:30 p.m. that for the second year in a row, the Kate Tech Champion student who will be recognized by the State Department at the Education and Business Summit this summer is a Richland 2 student, and this year it is Colin Busby.
All right, congratulations.
And last, we have the fun demonstration by our fire and emergency management student from Westwood, Mr. Parker Smith. Are you going to speak first or do first? Are you
How are you guys doing today?
Good. How are you?
My name is Parker Smith. I'm currently a junior at Westwood High School. I'm in Westwood's firefighting class and their EMS class, so I've got tons of certifications coming out of that, so that looks good on applications, resumes, and all that good stuff. Coming out of the fire class, you get 9 college credits in fire management or fire science. So when I graduate next year, I'll go to Greenville Tech and do that, and then come out a full-time firefighter. And firefighters, they work 24 on, 48 off, so I'll have plenty of free time to make other money. So do that just for the benefits. And in that class, we work as a team, do all hands-on activities, and both of, or we're actually doing it for two classes. We're not only doing it for the high school, but we're also doing it for the fire academy. And when we come out of there with both Fire 1 and Fire 2, we get a national certification. So even though if you move from South Carolina to like somewhere across the nation, you can still get a job in the fire service.
Very good.
Put on your hat for me.
Yeah. All right. Yeah.
And back to Ms. Gregory's comments about service, the fire kids at Westwood, they are real into service. They show up at just about every elementary school, every middle school that invites them for their career days. They are there talking to the students. They have learned a lot about presentation, and I hope that that part has enriched their experience as well. So just real pleased with these three students. Colin Busby has actually, prompted me to think about different ways that we can look at Kate, and I hope that I continue to do that and try to grow professionally as I do that. But he was a student at Blythewood who wanted to take auto mechanics, and we only had that at one school. So again, we always have to be thinking about how we can do this. Med 2 is our first experiment in extending some courses into the afternoon. And just want to keep Kate growing always and looking for new ways to serve students. So that's my presentation. I'll be happy to take questions if you have any.
Board members, questions or comments?
Mr. Chair.
Yes, ma'am.
First of all, let me just say thank you for presenting Kate. I'm a former Kate teacher, and it means so much to me because although we want all of our students to go to college, not everyone is going to college. So it's great to see that we have these certification programs where students can graduate and go straight into the workforce. And you kind of touched on the question that I had because I was going to ask, what if there's a student at a different school and that program is not offered? How do we provide success for that student if that's something they want to become going to the fireworks? How do we prepare for that student?
Thank you. What we've been trying to do the last 2 years is make sure that Kate is represented at the choice fairs so that people have awareness that if you are zoned for one school but you want to be in cosmetology or barbering, that you need to choice to one of the schools that has that to offer. It's not perfect yet, and it, like I said, it is one of the areas that we continue to think about and how to extend programming. And some of those one programs like that we have are really expensive programs, but we do need to continue to examine ways that we can serve students, and I hope we do that.
So how do we choice in if we have schools like Blythewood High who offers the criminal justice program and they don't accept choice?
Right. They actually don't offer the criminal justice program anymore. And so that is, like I said, back in that sweet spot. They did. They certainly did at one point. But when Westwood opened, they had to close a program, and that teacher transferred to another school to do something else on her choice. So that was the program that ended up getting closed by virtue of that. So that's why it's one of those sweet spot programs that I'd like to bring back at some point.
I guess now you just sparked. Because that teacher transferred to a different school, we closed the program?
Well, we closed the program because we were opening another high school and they were going to be opening new Kate programs. And they went into the same area, but they went with fire and emergency. The fire and emergency is grouped under the law and safety and all of that.
So we have a teacher now at Westwood who is teaching criminal justice?
No, she's not teaching. He's not teaching criminal justice. He's teaching fire and emergency services.
Okay, I guess I'm confused because the teacher that was at Blythewood High School is a female.
That's
transferred
correct.
To Westwood.
That's correct. To do another job she applied for.
Right, so then we just did away with the program altogether.
We had to take away one program when Blythewood lost all those students.
So actually the program
closed. It was just
hers
because she transferred to do something else.
So we closed the program?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, we were kind of bouncing around that. So actually the program closed when a teacher moved to a different position. So we need to try to see how we can get that program back in place, because that program was very successful at Blythewood High School under Mr. Price. And then I know that person moved on to Westwood. Mm-hmm. So I would love to see how we can continue that program, because it was very successful.
Yep, more money.
Yeah.
Not being facetious, but I
didn't realize
but, I mean,
it closed because the teacher yeah. left.
Right.
All right, other questions or comments? Yes, ma'am.
Thank you for Thank your you. For your presentation. And couple of, just one of the things that I preach about and is near and dear to me is diversity, mm-hmm. and how it has less to do with the color of your skin or where you're from, but your worldview, your strengths, your talents. So I appreciate the diversity that Kate offers, skill sets with Mark. My mom always talks about it, who's an educator, and always talks about it. It matters less how smart you are, but how are you smart? Yeah. And I appreciate the Kate programs because they offer so many marketable skills, 150 plus credentials and Perkins Performance, awesome. But to offer students marketable skills and to know that in District 2, students can be a part of Kate programs and classes and other programs they're involved in. I know that in other school districts, sometimes you know, back in the day they had tracks you were on, you know, a college track and this track, but you can be a part of and utilize any kind of educational opportunities as well as Kate, and I appreciate that, the diversity that it offers and the marketable skills and the certifications when these students leave programs and they already have certifications under their belt, they're just making themselves more marketable and employable in the workforce. I appreciate that. One of the things I think I touched on before is like the culinary arts program, looking at making it self-sustainable and revenue generating. I think we talked about that maybe may not be under your purview, but the culinary arts program, having the students to be able to cater and things like that to generate their own revenue. I'm not sure if that's a vision or something that you all
we would
are looking at in the future, because it could be self-sustaining.
I think that the schools that have culinary programs benefit from that quite a bit.
Yeah,
they do use their students to cater quite a bit. I'm not sure how much revenue it generates as money it saves from
sure.
not buying food from a restaurant and bringing
sure.
it in.
Sure.
But they definitely use their students and use the students to cater. And
great
I will say this.
As well. Great experience.
Right. It's a great experience. And several of our schools have been invited to be active participants in community events as well.
Awesome.
Blythewood High students always make a lot of the food ahead of time for the Italian festival and even help make some of the food for the Greek festival. Richland Northeast catered a large event up at the Marriott for a professional group that was having their annual meeting there. Great opportunities for those students.
Great. And I appreciate your meeting with me previously whenever I've had questions to ask
yes.
about Kate, and you've met with me privately, and not privately, but because I've asked
Happy
you
to do that.
Career prep. How do we look with regard to growth in that area? Does
career prep
fall under Kate? Yeah, just
career prep's actually going through some exciting changes right now.
Okay.
We are migrating to sort of a whole new system next year where students will be, again, I keep using the word credentials, but they
mm-hmm.
are going to earn credentials.
Good.
And
Good.
The students in there, we have got 3 to 4 different employers lined up that are going to let those students work with them and get on-the-job training.
Okay.
And get certificates like from EnviroAg in irrigation systems.
I'm glad to know that.
They're doing the forklift training here at R2I2. We have them working with Chef Richard Rouse down at the First Baptist Church Kitchens.
Okay.
And they are getting great experiences really all over town.
I'm glad to know that mm-hmm. with regard to career prep. Because
Thank
I know
you
they,
for remembering those students, yes.
Good. Good to know.
All right. Board members, other Thank questions you. Or comments? I appreciate you presenting. You know, I asked to have this done because I know we have several board members that have a lot of interest in this, and
mm-hmm.
I keep hearing that, like, we don't have Kate in this district.
Mm-hmm.
And I know I came to you and said, I keep hearing we don't have Kate. I don't know where this is coming from. And when we look at the litany of things that you're doing and the constant growth we have in that area and the dedication that we have, I think it's a story that I wanted to make sure that we all heard and that we go forth and tell others when we hear that is not the case.
Right.
We do have Kate, a very thriving Kate program here, and appreciate the work you're doing. And the students, if they want to practice irrigation, they can come to my house anytime. They don't have to ask. They can dig wherever they want and help me with that.
That's great.
Anyways, thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, next we have policy EF, Dr. Hamm.
We're continuing our work on updating our policy manual. And the proposal EF has to do with food service. It really brings us into compliance with some new requirements. And Jack Carter has been working on that.
The state recently required that all school districts have a food service policy. And we had not had one. While we've been heavily regulated by both the federal government and the state, they never required an actual written policy. So I went out and researched every district I could find in the state that had one that was similar in size, and I shamelessly stole some of their language and put it into, it's a very simple, straightforward policy. And I'll be glad to answer any questions about this policy.
Board members, questions or comments? I see it doesn't say it has to taste good or have like spaghetti and cinnamon rolls in there.
Okay, I have artillery ears, I'm sorry. Can I just say one thing? Both Service Solutions and EnviroAg are hiring some of our career prep kids as interns, paid interns. The high school kids are actually going to work on their campuses, helping maintain their campuses. And Service Solutions is trying to work out how you do that with, because the kids would have to go to another campus to work. Typically, they would not work on their own campus, but they're trying to work that out. And my dad was a fireman, so.
Yeah. And the penny tax, you know, does allow program has paid internships as well. The penny tax program.
They're paid internships.
Yeah, for anybody who wants to apply.
And Sodexo is trying to work with our culinary students to hire them as event staff people because we can't hire enough people and keep them on staff when we have large events. So they've been using a temp agency, but they're trying to work with the schools, and they'll actually be on the Sodexo payroll for certain events.
Ms. Mack.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Carter. I appreciate knowing that EnviroAg is working with, the Career Prep is not a diploma, you know, program.
Career Prep
is not a diploma program, so I know we get kind of some flack about that, wondering, you know, what it does. So I'd love it if we could share some of those things that we're doing with Career Prep so that students will know about opportunities and the community will know that Career Prep does have some viable ends as well. That's partnership with the district. So people will know about those opportunities. It'd be great to share that. I'm glad to hear that.
And at least in the case of EnviroAg, they can certify the kids on pesticide and herbicide
applications. That's
just great
to share.
Because they have, Dr. Lynn is qualified to do that, as is his own staff landscape architect. So.
Great.
Maybe if we find some budget money, we can double Libby's $30,000 for advertising.
I'm sorry?
Said if we find some money in the budget, maybe we can double our advertising budget to help get the word out about some of these things.
Well,
or just be creative.
We're working with the career prep folks and the principals at the high schools to try to identify people.
We can do it internally in the schools. Thank you so much.
Other questions or comments? All right, thank you very much. You. Next, item 13.4, policy revisions, BB and BBA.
Policy BB is a newly edited policy, actually. It has some strikes and adds that mostly have to do with the legal references and clarifies the board's responsibilities to the community. Policy BBA has a more extensive list of the board's responsibilities concerning hiring and evaluating the superintendent, planning, budgeting, and responsibilities to the community and public. So we're proposing those two policies, and we'll be asking for action at the next meeting.
Board members, questions or comments? All right, next on our agenda, item 14.1, items for May the 2nd.
Policies that we just went over, that's EF, BB, and BBA. And then we'll have further proposals for policy revisions that would include
BBAA, BBB, BBBC, and BBBE.
All right, all the B's.
All the B's.
All the bees. All right, board members, anything you'd like to see on this or future agendas?
Manning, and yes. I think we've touched on this before. I'm not sure how we decided to address it. With regard to Blythewood Academy, I think we were going to talk about how it's working with integrating the elementary kids.
Yeah,
there.
I think that we decided we were going to try to get with staff, and if once we did that, that we would, if there were further questions, we would come back.
Okay.
I mean, if I'll you've do done that. That and you have questions, then okay. We can add that on.
That's fine. Okay, thank okay. you.
Yeah. All right, other items we'd like to see on this are future agendas. All right, we have now our second public participation. We have no one who signed up at this time. If there's anybody who would like the opportunity to speak, please come forward and do so now. All right, next on our agenda is board and superintendent comments. I will start with Mr. Shad and work my way to my left.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to welcome everyone back from spring break. It was a time to rest, reflect, relax, and then get recharged for this final quarter. The finish line is near. I know folks are tired. I just know that. Folks are tired. All up and down in terms of our stakeholders, our children have done well. I would just encourage our parents as they continue to partner with the schools and our instructional leaders that they have the same mindset that they had at the beginning of the school year, where they were making sure that they got to school on time, that their children had enough rest, and that they were working with them on projects. Let's finish strong. We do have testing season coming up, so let's continue to have that testing mindset as we had in years past. And of course, thank you all for the wonderful recognitions. Thank you to our executive staff, and especially the faculty focus, and let's just continue to do a great job. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kosher Parker.
Good meeting this evening, kind of long, but it's a good meeting. I want to say congratulations to all of our award winners and the recognitions this evening, and thank you, Harry and Shelley and Penny, and good luck as you wind this down. And a great CAPE report, Mary Page, thank you.
Ms. Plank.
Yeah, in addition to what's been said, I you know, it's tough when we go into this budget time because, as you can imagine, you want to fund everything. And like in your own personal budgets, when you look at personal finance, you have to make some tough decisions. One of the challenges is the balance between doing what we need to do to educate our kids and provide the best educational experience, and at the same time, we have a tax group, the businesses in this case, because this is what's funding our general budget. And what do we do and how do we handle that, which puts further pressure on the tax increases to businesses that we try to then attract into the district to then have kids in the school. So it's a real challenge at times. I want to, again, thank Dr. Miley and his team for the work you guys do. You're scrambling to get these numbers very quickly to us, and I appreciate that. So I think it's evident from up here that we take it very seriously and we go through it very carefully. So thank you for that. Thank you for the presentations. And then finally, I just want to end with, I had the opportunity with, along with some other board members who attended Ellis Fitzgerald Hawkins II's funeral at Westwood. It was a neat celebration of life. I did not know him. I had a chance to meet with their family and spend some time there, a dynamic family. And it was just a really touching experience. And it's neat to see, again, the family element of Richland, too, and how we opened up the school, brought in the sports teams, and were able to really celebrate the life of this young man. And what an amazing young man he is. It was truly a celebration. It's tough when we lose someone in our family. And I just wanted to end that thank you for all you do and to make it that type of environment. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Mackey.
Not to be redundant, but I wanted to reiterate in my board members' comments. And the only thing I was going to say tonight, because I knew that everybody else would thank you for the presentations and I echo those sentiments, is to echo those sentiments about Westwood High School and Ellis Hawkins. I know that he's a member of my extended family's church. Their family, when their church couldn't accommodate all those people, Westwood came forth and opened their arms. And we talk about the analogy that Nancy gave tonight with regard to a river being a vessel that receives as well as gives. And that's a tangible example of what we do in Richland too, of giving back when we need to. And so I just want to applaud Westwood High School for opening its doors to that family, and praying for that family still. That's a bitter wound, but just wanted to thank you for being an example of what we say we stand for, tangibly.
Thank you. Ms. Agostini.
I'd also like to thank the presenters and congratulate our diverse group of talented staff and students that were recognized this evening. And also, just wanted to comment on how pleased I was to see the administration, the teachers, and the board work together to keep our open door policy at our schools. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Elkins-Johnson.
And I hate to be redundant as well, but first of all, I want to say thank you to Nancy Gregory for that wonderful, inspirational moment. Also, congratulations to the presenters tonight. And I also want to commend Dr. Shura Guy and her team for welcoming the Hawkins family. Ellis and Lisa and I all went to college together, so we have been friends for a very long time. So it meant so much to just see the community come together. And Dr. Guy, for what you did, and your team, just kudos to you, and thank you for showing that love and that compassion and that family that we say we are in Richland, too. So thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Hamm.
This is time of year where we worry about our students as they're celebrating, going to proms, et cetera, sometimes entering into some kind of risky situations. And I want to give a shout out to Project CARE that's put out a number of billboards just reminding students to make smart decisions this time of year and throughout the summer. And then also Project CARE put on a program called Sticker Shock that really informs adults about not providing alcohol and alcohol-related drugs to students who don't need to have them when they're underage. So they're doing some good work at a really critical point in the school year, and I want to thank them for that work. I also want to mention that next Saturday, April the 29th, is the Sparkleberry Fair, and I get to serve as the Grand Marshal.
All right.
Starting at 11:30, and Mr. Plank, you're going to be the MC, so I hope people come to Sparkleberry Fair. there's the milk, you know, there's a milking contest you want to see. And actually, it's a wonderful thing for Richland, too. They give us about $50,000 in scholarships and grants to our teachers. Mm-hmm. So that's a pretty amazing thing that our community does with us, and I hope everybody will come out and support that great effort. Ridgeview High School is hosting a Blazer Fest that day from 10 to 3 o'clock, so that's another community opportunity. And last but not least, we're winding down the Richland 2 Ready to Read program. We're trying to get 35,000 books to give to students in pre-K through second grade to encourage their reading. And so please, if you have new or gently used books that you can donate, I hope you'll do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hamm. I also want to echo the comments about Westwood High School. I also attended the funeral. It's such a, you know, double-edged sword. It's a very sad thing, but I think it also is a reminder of us to celebrate life and celebrate our students when we have the opportunity to do that. Also, we do have amazing partners in this district. Service and Solutions donated the time that day for their staff to set up and break down. And, you know, we just have many, many examples where we have so many of our partners that really become part of the Richland 2 family. And so we appreciate them and the service that they have. I will miss the Sparkleberry Fair. I did not take a break last week. I am taking a break at the end of April, and it just happens to be during that time. But that group is really dedicated to our students and our teachers, and it's such a big event and a part of the community. It has been for so long, so I'm really sorry that I'm not going to be there to watch the milking of the cows and to watch Mr. Plank talk. He's pretty good at that, and all the other things that we have going on with that, but I do appreciate those efforts. And, you know, as Mr. Shad stated, do appreciate the teachers and staff. I know it gets hard this time of year as we're chugging through. As a parent of a student, I understand it was nice to have a break from the homework, right, for at least 1 week. But we do have to finish strong and get through the end of the year. So thank you again for everyone. We look forward to seeing you again when we finalize the budget, right, Harry, in May. So thank you all very much. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Done.